Hello and welcome to episode 3 of the Red Book Podcast, the Tolkien podcast that focuses on exploring the works of J.R.R. Tolkien in depth. Episode 2 was an exploration of the servants of the Valar, Aule, those servants being Sauron and Saruman, the great evil figures during the time of the Lord of the Rings. What was their connection? What part did their former teacher have in their fall? And what led to their fall in the first place? You can listen to that episode and others on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Amazon Music and Stitcher under the name The Red Book. Those who would like to leave comments and discuss these episodes can do so on the video versions I upload to my YouTube channel, found at youtube.com/theredbook. And just before getting into today's subject, if you want to hear these episodes early, as well as watch my videos before anyone else, or just talk about Tolkien with me on Discord, you can support this project at patreon.com/theredbook. In this episode, I am going to focus on the first Dark Lord, Melkor, later known as Morgoth. More specifically, I want to examine the concept of Morgoth's ring, and what Tolkien calls the Marring of Arda. Morgoth's Ring is also the name of my favourite volume of the history of Middle-earth, which is where a lot of the information I will provide can be found. Volume 10. The name itself is taken from Tolkien's essay, Notes on Motives in the Silmarillion, found in that volume, where it says, Sauron's relatively smaller power was concentrated. Morgoth's vast power was disseminated. The whole of Middle-earth was Morgoth's ring, though temporarily his attention was mainly upon the northwest. Unless swiftly successful, war against him might well end in reducing all Middle-earth to chaos, possibly even all Arda. I will explain what Tolkien means here, but I should first start with the concept of Arda Marred, or the Marring of Arda. As always with Tolkien, there are a lot of terms to explain. Through the music of the Ainur, in which Melkor also played his part, the material universe, Ea, was brought into being by Eru. The music, with all its harmony and discord, took shape as a vision, which was taken away before any could see the end. Eru brought the universe into being. From there, many of the Ainur descended into what was made, and they would see that it was not as the vision had shown. There was work to do. The world was to be shaped and fashioned according to their designs, in preparation for those Eru would make to inhabit it. Arda is the world, shaped by the Valar with their helpers, the Maiar. This would be the home to creatures imagined by the Ainur in the music, and those brought into the world by Eru himself. But before Arda was made ready, we are told in Chapter 1 of the Silmarillion, of the beginning of days, that it is told among the wise that the first war began before Arda was full shaped, and ere yet there was anything that grew or walked upon earth. And for long Melkor had the upper hand. But in the midst of the war, a spirit of great strength and hardihood came to the aid of the Valar, hearing in the far heaven that there was a battle in the little kingdom, and Arda was filled with the sound of his laughter. So came Tulkas the Strong, whose anger passes like a mighty wind, scattering cloud and darkness before it. And Melkor fled before his wrath and his laughter, and forsook Arda, and there was peace for a long time. And Tulkas remained and became one of the Valar of the Kingdom of Arda. But Melkor brooded in the outer darkness, and his hate was given to Tulkas forever after. This allowed Arda to transition into the Spring of Arda, with the building of the two great lamps to light the earth. Melkor had fled to regroup and plan his next move, and this allowed the Valar to shape Arda to their will, without strife and conflict against Melkor. Arda was filled with birds and beasts. The Isle of Almarin at its centre, the home of the Valar at this time, it prospered, and there was calm and creativity. The symmetry and peace of Arda would, however, not last forever. Then Tulkas slept, being weary and content, and Melkor deemed that his hour had come, and he passed therefore over the walls of the night with his host, and came to Middle-earth far in the north, and the Valar were not aware of him. The Silmarillion, Chapter 1, of the Beginning of Days. The perfect habitation that the Valar were creating for the coming of the children of Iluvatar, that's elves as the firstborn and later men as the secondborn, would come to an end with what is called the Marring of Arda. Peace was disturbed when Melkor returned, and he introduced decay, poison, and evil. His great underground fortress of Utumno, that he constructed in secret, introduced sickness, and once again Chapter 1 of the Silmarillion explains Melkor's devastating impact on the world. Now Melkor began the delving and building of a vast fortress, deep under Earth, beneath dark mountains where the beams of Iluin were cold and dim. That stronghold was named Utumno, and though the Valar knew not of it as yet, nonetheless the evil of Melkor and the blight of his hatred flowed out thence, and the Spring of Arda was marred. Green things fell sick and rotted, and rivers were choked with weeds and slime, and fens were made, rank and poisonous, the breeding place of flies, and forests grew dark and perilous, the haunts of fear, and beasts became monsters of horn and ivory, and dyed the earth with blood. Then the Valar knew indeed that Melkor was at work again, and they sought for his hiding place. But Melkor, trusting in the strength of Utumno and the might of his servants, came forth suddenly to war, and struck the first blow, ere the Valar were prepared, and he assailed the lights of Iluin and Ormal, and cast down their pillars and broke their lamps. In the overthrow of the mighty pillars, lands were broken, and seas arose in tumult, and when the lamps were spilled, destroying flame was poured out over the earth. And the shape of Arda, and the symmetry of its waters and its lands was marred in that time, so that the first designs of the Valar were never after restored. The Marring of Arda was more than the destruction of the lamps and the perfectly symmetrical Arda becoming disjointed and broken. It was the introduction of corruption into all aspects of the Valar's designs. Melkor strove against the works of the Valar. If they created a valley, he would fill it. If they raised a mountain from the earth, he would attempt to topple it. It was a relentless rebellion, an attempt to unmake or corrupt all their plans, and everything they had imagined from the vision set forth by Eru at the beginning of all things. His evil influence spread from his fortress. Plants and animals would become sick. A poisonous miasma of hatred, envy, and greed would breed flies, introduce choking weeds. Animals would prey upon another for the first time, all achieved through Melkor's power and desire. An attempt at a perfect world, undone before elves had even awoken, meaning they would be born into a world already tainted, never having the experience of the Spring of Arda and the true vision of the Valar. And Melkor wrought great ruin with fire and deadly cold, and marred all that the other Valar made. The History of Middle-earth, Volume 10, Morgoth's Ring, The Annals of Aman. I am sure most listening are familiar with the One Ring of Sauron, Melkor's greatest servant, and later another Dark Lord. The externalization of a substantial portion of his innate power of mind and spirit into the physical world through a golden ring. A ring that would enhance his power on Earth. Morgoth's ring is to him as the One Ring is to Sauron. But instead of externalizing his great power into a ring, or focused into one object, Morgoth externalized his own power into the physical matter of Arda itself. Arda is Morgoth's ring. Morgoth was far greater than Sauron, once existing as the mightiest of all in the physical world, and as Tolkien pondered his mythology in his later years, he considered the myth of light, the nature of the Blessed Realm, the immortality of the elves and their reincarnation, the fall of men, the origin of orcs, but above all he considered the power and significance of the chief foe of Arda, enlarging his role to become not only its chief foe, but the ground and source of the corruption of the earth. His enormously greater power was dispersed into the fabric of Arda. How did Melkor achieve this? Well, Tolkien thankfully doesn't provide a mechanical explanation when it comes to details like this. Power is able to remain as a vague concept, but one we can grasp. This is because we can see the fruits of Melkor's labour. His once insurmountable stature was broken into his devices and plots. He made or corrupted evil servants and slaves, willing them on, creatures such as orcs, trolls, and even dragons. He perverted the gift of men, the gift for mankind to shape his own destiny free of the music in a short space of time before willingly departing the world with no fear. This was perverted into a great fear of death and the unknown. Instead of embracing the unknown, man would have his relationship with Arda tainted. Some eventually clinging onto life even as old men, weak and weary, not of sound mind, seeing this as a better fate than willingly passing into what we can assume is a greater bliss outside of Arda with the One. The shadow of Melkor took root in their hearts, and the gift was dreaded and unwanted. Death is their fate, the gift of Iluvatar, which as time wears even the powers shall envy. But Melkor has cast his shadow upon it, and confounded it with darkness, and brought forth evil out of good, and fear out of hope. The Silmarillion, Chapter 1 of The Beginning of Days. I view the corruption of elves and men in a broader sense as part of Melkor's ambition, an attempt to sow distrust and suspicion between the children and the powers. What better way to corrupt the earth than to have those the world was made for fear and even loathe those who made it for them? His marring of Arda caused the waning of the elves. Elves naturally existed as a union of spirit and body. They relied on the earth for not only their physical forms, but the sustaining of their physical forms. They now had to rely on a tainted earth to thrive or even survive, meaning that Melkor had placed himself within everything, like a poisonous seed. Where men would fear the gifts they had been granted by Eru, elves would have the world that was shaped for them tainted. They would awaken and fight a long battle against an earth that would make them weary with its corruption. We can then say that the Marring of Arda, the strife that exists within it, is all a part of Morgoth's ring, the pouring of his own naturally mighty spirit into mockeries, misdeeds, and suffering would decrease his own personal natural power, his own being, but would increase the power and dominion he held over what the earth made and sustained, over those who relied on it for their existence. Meaning, despite a weaker form, Melkor could only be completely destroyed through the destruction of what held his power, the destruction of Arda itself. For even if we, under Eru, have the power to return to Middle-earth, and cast out Morgoth from the kingdom of Arda, we cannot destroy all the evil that he has sown, nor seek out all his servants, unless we ravaged the whole of the kingdom, and made an end of all life therein, and that we may not do. The History of Middle-earth, Volume 12, The Peoples of Middle-earth, Late Writings, The Problem of Rhos. So let's get into more detail about how this was achieved and why he would do this. Melkor incarnated himself permanently. The Ainur, that's the Valar and the Maiar, do not naturally exist in a state of union between body and spirit. Elves do and men do, but the Ainur do not require bodies. Yet their motives can lead them to inhabiting physical forms, as Melkor wished to control the physical matter of Arda, its inhabitants included, he placed himself within it, becoming a part of it. This is what Tolkien calls a vaster and more perilous procedure when compared to Sauron, and his plan with the Great Rings of Power in the Second Age. With the Valar dwelling in the Blessed Realm, everything outside of that place would have a part of Melkor, known as the Melkor ingredient. And as I said earlier, all who were nourished through the body of Arda would never be free of his influence. Everything would lean towards him, very slightly or to a great extent. And with the body and spirit relying on each other for unity, one being influenced or corrupted would in turn influence or corrupt the other. This seems like a great idea, the inability to be completely destroyed without the destruction of the world itself, something you know the Valar would not commit to doing just to defeat Morgoth. This did work against him in that he could now be defeated. A defeat can come without annihilation. Tolkien tells us in Myths Transformed that Melkor had to be made far more powerful in his original nature when compared to the rest of the Valar. He was to be the greatest power under Eru, his original purpose being to make, devise and begin. The King of Arda, Manwë, was a little less great, though still far greater than we can comprehend. He was to improve, carry out and complete the work started by Melkor. In an ideal world, they'd work together to create something neither would achieve on their own. This stretches to the rest of the Valar, showing us why Melkor shared in all their gifts, allowing each to improve upon his creative genius, that spark of creativity. In the early days, Melkor was so great that the Valar combined would not be able to control or chain him. And yes, this includes Tulkas according to Tolkien. Melkor in the early age of Arda was alone able to drive all of them out of Middle-earth into retreat, following the destruction of the lamps. Such is the might attributed to him in his original nature. But as he released his power into the earth and his devices, this dynamic changed, as we are told in the following quote. The war against Utumno was only undertaken by the Valar with reluctance, and without hope of real victory, but rather as a covering action or diversion, to enable them to get the Quendi out of his sphere of influence. But Melkor had already progressed some way towards becoming the Morgoth, a tyrant, or central tyranny and will plus his agents. Only the total contained the old power of the complete Melkor, so that if the Morgoth could be reached or temporarily separated from his agents, he was much more nearly controllable and on a power level with the Valar. The History of Middle-earth, Volume 10, Morgoth's Ring, Myths Transformed. The Valar were at the time reluctant to engage with Melkor, believing that they could not achieve a victory. As Tolkien says, their war against Melkor, known as the Battle of the Powers or War for the Sake of Elves, was one they fought thinking they couldn't win. It was to distract Melkor in order to remove elves from his influence. But when the war was fought, the Valar found they could swiftly deal with the agents of Melkor, his servants, slaves and armies. They reached his underground fortress of Utumno, and Melkor was unable to shield himself from physical contact, as he had once been able to do in the days of his greatness. As far back as the days when the elves woke up in Middle-earth, Melkor had started to diminish, through the continued development of Morgoth's ring. Manwë at last faces Melkor again, as he has not done since he entered Arda. Both are amazed. Manwë to perceive the decrease in Melkor as a person, Melkor to perceive this also from his own point of view. He now has less personal force than Manwë, and can no longer daunt him with his gaze. The History of Middle-earth, Volume 10, Morgoth's Ring, Myths Transformed. This dissemination of his power has Melkor lust to have creatures beneath him. He desires to rule them and dominate them, or even destroy them if he wishes it so. This becomes habitual and necessary, tightening this bond between his spirit and this physical form he inhabits, developing a fear of losing it, suffering the weaknesses of those he wishes to lord over. This whole process was then something that could only be reversed if Morgoth fully repented, in what Tolkien calls unfeigned self-abasement. the one thing Morgoth would be completely unwilling to do, falling deeper and deeper into delusion, arrogance, and folly. Even after reaching the point where he would see himself as the mightiest of all, despite his power becoming dispersed between his own being and his agents, or as Tolkien calls it, a central tyranny and will plus his agents. Those agents can be dealt with independently, and this will have an effect on the tyranny, the Empire of Morgoth. He can now be directly challenged. His reliance on this form leads to him becoming a shadow of his former self. As the corruption of Arda spreads, his form he inhabits basically weakens. No longer that great spirit brought into the world by Eru. He can suffer wounds that do not heal, as we witness when the High King of the Noldor, Fingolfin, directly challenges him at the gates of Angband. This was something unimaginable at a time when he was great enough to deal with the combined strength of the powers through his own greatness. All of this is Morgoth's ring, the state of Arda, the evil we see within it, the decay and sorrow. Morgoth's attempt to utterly control that which he claimed as his own, his attempt to identify himself with Arda. He sees it as his kingdom, naming it unto himself as he descends into it crowned in smoke and fire. He manages to achieve his desire to mar Arda, and influence everything in some way, but he falls in his arrogance, by losing that power that protected him. While the eradication of Sauron was possible through the destruction of one object, the One Ring, Morgoth, as said, could not be made impotent while in the physical world, because of Morgoth's ring. Yet, he had made himself weak enough to be imprisoned, weak enough to be executed, and pushed through the door of night into the void. He would not be there to witness his work in action beyond the first stage. Arda was marred. All would suffer in ways great and small because of him, but his fall from glory led him to darkness, far from the light of creation, outside of Arda, separated from the world he claimed as his own, separated from the world he poured so much of his will into, in an effort to control, rule and destroy. There is hope, with the elves believing that the world will come to an end, their immortality lasting as long as the world lasts. After that, there is the belief that Eru will make a new world, the ending of Arda Mard, the creation of a new Arda, incorporating all the triumphs and lessons learnt from the failures of the previous into a new thing and greater. Morgoth's ring then arguably becomes the greatest example of Melkor being an instrument of Eru, his evil will leading to things more wonderful, which he himself had not imagined. Thank you for listening to this latest episode of the Red Book Podcast. Much of this episode was taken from my video, What is Morgoth's Ring?, which you can find on my YouTube channel. But talking about Arda Mard, the corruption of Melkor, is one of my favourite topics, and I hope you enjoyed listening to my thoughts on this over me just explaining the history of Morgoth to you. The personality, motives, and downfall of Melkor found in Tolkien's works beyond the Silmarillion make this character one of the most interesting, and I'm happy to talk about this figure as often as I can manage. I want to thank my supporters on Patreon, and say that if you have any questions or thoughts on this topic, please leave them for me on YouTube. I hope you will return for the next chapter of the Red Book. Thanks again.